webinar series at IIT Bombay. And today's speaker is Dr. Raul Arnold. So he is AIID senior researcher from Zaragoza, University of Zaragoza, Spain. So before introducing the speaker, let me give a brief overview of what is SIF. So SIF is basically located at IIT Bombay. This is sophisticated analytical instrumental facility. It is funded by Department of Science and Technology. So SIF is merged with CRNTS. I think my slides are not moving, looks like. Sorry for that. Let me share it again. So SIF is merged with CRNTS in 2006, and it has various major equipments, and it is funded inaugurated in 1978 by our previous Prime Minister, late Shri Morarji Desai, and there are many number of samples are analyzed across India using this facility. And these are the some of the major facilities available at SIF at IIT Bombay, and some of them are spectroscopic techniques, and some of them are microscopic techniques, and also structural analysis techniques. And some of the recent additions are dual beam FIB equipped with FAJ-SEM, and recently we also able to have a addition of EELS to our 300 kV transmission electron microscope. And other some of the facilities at CRNTS are listed here. So this is a 300 kV FAJ-TEM. It is equipped with both EELS and EDS. So it is located SIF IIT Bombay. So if you want to know more about SIF, you can go to SIF website, sif.iitb.ac.in. And if you have any samples to be analyzed, so there is a step-by-step guide to register a sample for analysis. Please go through that one. And if you have any questions, we can write to office.sif@iitb.ac.in. And we analyze samples across India, and also sometimes we get sample from Nepal and so on. And there are several visitors to this department. And you can also join us on LinkedIn. So here we post recent events conducted by SIF IIT Bombay. And all the recordings of these webinars we post in YouTube channel, that is Webinar SIF IIT Bombay. So you can go through that one too. And we have a excellent staff at SIF and CRNTS, and they are very happy to analyze your samples, and headed by Professor Anil Kotantiyak. Coming to the today's webinar on, so it is my personal pleasure to introduce Professor Raul Arnold. So he is AIID senior researcher, Institute of Nanoscience and Materials of Argonne, INMA, University of Zaragoza, Spain. Is also director of the TEM area of the lab Microscopia Avanza, University of Zaragoza. He did his PhD from University of Paris in 2005, France, is a Marie Curie student. He obtained his habilitation at this university in 2013, and he did his postdoctoral studies for about 2.5 years in Electron Microscope Center of Argonne National Laboratory, United States of America. At 2007, he joined at CNRS France as a research scientist. Then he moved to 2012 to ARAID research scientist at Laboratory of Microscopia Avanzadas LMA of the University of Zaragoza, Spain. And he has been invited scientist at several places, including Electron Microscope Center of Argonne National Laboratory in 2008, USA, and in 2000, 2010 to 2011 is a visiting scientist at LMA of the University of Zaragoza, Spain. He is also visiting scientist at University of Namur, Belgium from 2013 to 2016. Is also visiting scientist in Tianjin University of Technology, China in 2019. His broad research of interest is electron microscopy for materials and nanoscience to understand the growth mechanisms and physical properties of these materials. He published more than 220 articles, one book and six book chapters. With the citations, more than 8,000 citations with the H index of 48. And he gave more than 90 invited talks, and he is a promoter and chair of Heteronanocarbon Conference Series started in 2013. And I got a pleasure to go there once. And he is a member of several scientific societies of Europe, including Young Academy of Europe, and there are many. And he's also associate editor for more than 10 journals, including some of them are Nature Publishing journals. For example, Applied Microscopy is also associate editor in Carbon Trends, Nanomaterials, and so on. So with that brief introduction, I would like to invite Raoul Arnold to give his talk on EELS. And one small note for the whoever participating in the webinar, if you have any questions, please post in the chat box. Okay. With that, I would welcome Professor Raoul Arnold to give his talk. Raoul.
So good afternoon, and thank you very much, Lila, for this kind introduction and for the invitation. It's a pleasure for me to be with you. Fortunately, it's by internet, it's online, but it's also a pleasure. So in any case, this is the title of my lecture. As Lila said, it's devoted to the study of electron energy loss spectroscopy. So I will cover more or less the whole subject in 45 minutes. So be aware that will be really a little bit fast. So if you have questions and so on, as it has been said, you can post them in the chat, or we can discuss via email. You see here my email address. You can contact me anytime. So I am coming, as it has been said, from Zaragoza, which is here in the middle between Madrid and Barcelona. And there we have a national facility for electron microscopy in this advanced microscopy lab. So as is similar at some point to the site, but in this case it's a national facility, and we are also involved in some important European projects for electron microscopy, like the STEAM3. If you are interested, you can go to the website of this STEAM3 project and you will see the different partners and the kind of activities that we are doing. And in our institute, we have 4 TM microscopes, and 2 of them, here on the right, are aberration corrected microscopes. One is probe corrected with monochromator, this one here at the top, and the other one is image with an image corrector. And in both of them we have a GIF, so we have the possibility to perform EELS, as we will see. This is my team. It's a nanoscopy on low dimensional materials. It's a current picture of the group and the funding that is supporting my research. So let's go to the lecture itself. As I say, I will cover more or less everything in a fast way related with EELS. So we will see what is the principle and the generalities of the technique, the instrumentation that we need to perform this approach. And after, we will see what are the kind of informations that we can get for the analysis of the core losses and the low losses, and the kind illustrated by examples that I think that can also bring you the attention, or can have the possibility to have some ideas about your materials and the kind of works that can be done on them. So, as usual in TM, so we are using an electron probe that is going through a material. In this case, it's a crystalline one, but could be also an amorphous material. And we have some interactions from these electrons with the electrons of the atoms, and we are collecting different signals due to this interaction of the fast electrons from the probe, or from the source, to to these ones of the atoms. Today we will focus in the inelastic events. So these ones that the electrons are losing some, in this case, some energy. They are transferring some energy to the atom, and we will measure this loss of energy. Here are more or less the picture of the kind of events that we can have, the elastic and inelastic ones. As I say, today we will focus on these ones. We'll see what is the kind of transitions that we can see once we are proving EELS. And once we are talking about EELS and with the previous picture, we can see that we once we are doing this process of interacting some fast electrons with our sample, as you know, we are collecting several signals, apart from the EELS that I was describing. You know that we can also have some inelastic electrons that they are also producing some EELS rays photons that can be collected in parallel with the measurements in EELS in particular, and with also some elastic or inelastic electrons in order to form images and so on. And in some cases you can have also the possibility to record photons in the visible and to perform cathode luminescence. But today we will focus in these two kind of examples. The analysis of the code losses, where we have information about the chemical composition of your sample, and with the response to the electromagnetic interactions via the plasmons or the measurements of the band gaps and so on, once we are looking for the analysis of the low losses. So here we have a whole EELS spectrum. In this case, is a boron nitride material, and we can see the two regions that I was describing before. We have the core losses, which is related with the absorption edges. Here we have the boron and the nitrogen KH, and after we have the second region, which is this one of the low losses, that is below, more or less, is arbitrary decision, but below 50 dBs, and there we will see what are the kind of transitions that we are proving. And after we have this red peak here, which is also very important, is the zero loss peak, which is considered this one that is the elastic peak. I mean that the electrons are not transferring energy to the sample. It's not really true, but it's okay. It's the way to see, at least in this basic level. Okay, so these are the kind of transitions that we are proving once we are performing EELS. In the core loss region, we have here the transitions from the core states, in the case of the KHs, from the 1s core states to the vacuum, to the unoccupied states. In the case here on the right of the manganese L23H, we are proving the transitions from the 2p core states again to the vacuum. We are always proving these transitions to the unoccupied states. And after, in the low loss region, where we are dealing with the plasmons and the inter-interbands transitions, are these kind of transitions from the valence states again to the conduction states. And we will see some examples of the kind of plasmonics and measurements and the optoelectronic properties of materials proved by EELS analyzing this region. Concerning the instrumentation, everything is basic in this spectrometer that is more or less based in a magnetic prism. So we have our electrons that, as I say, they are interacting with the sample. And once we are applying a magnetic field perpendicular to the trajectory of these electrons, these electrons that they are losing some energy will be deflected following the Lorentz force. So it means that these ones, depending on the speed of these electrons, they will project it in this dispersion plane at different places, depending of the energy of these electrons. So if this and which is, as I say, based in the Lorentz force. It's a spectrometer that is two-fold focusing, and that is why once if you are introducing in this dispersion plane and slit, you have the possibility to form an image, and it's something that is important for the TEM energy filter TEM technique that today I don't have time to go through, but the principle is here. So you are putting here an slit, you are selecting electrons that they are losing some particular energy, and with them you are forming an image, or you can do also is that in diffraction, and so you are selecting only a particular characteristic electrons of a loss energy. Okay, knowing that, we have two different ways to implement this kind of spectrometers. The first one here on the left is this one, the most common one, which is in the post-column spectrometer, which is normally a GIF, a Gatan image filter, like this one that you have in the site, and we have here in Zaragoza. We see here the magnetic prism, and you have all the lenses and so on, and after you have a detector that will be a CCD camera, CMOS camera, or now an electron direct camera, but in any case you have there the possibility to collect these electrons and to perform the spectroscopy analysis. The second example is here on the right, which is in the column spectrometer or filter. In this case, it's an omega filter. It's true that it's not the most used kind of filter, but it's also very interesting. For instance, if you are doing omega Q, also momentum resolve EELS, that could be a very good instrument for this one. Okay, so once you are doing EELS, you are building this data cube, which is a three-dimensional object that is composed by the two spatial dimensions, which are X and Y, from your projection image. And the third one will be the loss, the energy loss. And in this case, the data cube can be built in two ways. This one that is called a spectrum image, which is this one that I will describe extensively during the rest of the lecture, which is that for each proposition, we will collect an EELS whole EELS spectrum, and the other one is called image spectrum, which is the filter image or filter electron diffraction pattern, which in this case you are building the data cube cutting horizontally in this picture. So for you are getting an image, for instance, for each loss energy that you are interested. As I say, we will focus today in EELS STEM, so in the way of perform EELS in an scanning transmission electron microscope. And as I say, we will focus in this technique, in the spectrum image. So you see here the X and Y direction and the loss energy that is the way to build this data cube that has been developed by the group of Christian colleagues more than 30 years ago in Auxerre, in Paris, France. How is working? So here you have an example. You have a nanoparticle here of iron oxide, you will see, and we have our probe. And in this case, we are scanning the probe, and for each proposition, for every pixel that you are seeing here, depending on the size of the region that you are analyzing, you are collecting a EELS spectrum, as we saw here. And after, once you have this spectra, you can add them and you can do the elemental analysis, and in this case to see the distribution of oxygen and the distribution of iron from the analysis of this spectra. Okay, that is in 2D, but you can also do that in 1D, so that is called spectrum line in this case. You see here a single wall boron nitro nanotube that was performed in this microscope, in the VG, the old VG vacuum generator, which is a dedicated EELS microscope. And the way to perform the analysis is the same. So in this case, you have you are deciding that you are going through this nanotube in the, following this line, and after, for each proposition, you are collecting one EELS spectrum, and that is the boron and the nitrogen edge. If I am selecting one of the spectra, we will see the three different kind of informations that you can get from the analysis of the core loss in EELS. The first one is this one that we already mentioned, the elemental analysis. We can know that we are dealing with boron and nitrogen. The second one is that we can perform quantification, and it's something that we will see later. So we can know, for instance, in this example, that we have a pure boron nitrogen nanotube because the stoichiometry is one by one. Okay, doing the analysis of the quantifying the number of atoms of this of each of these elements. And the third one, and probably the most important one from the EELS, and you will see the impact that it has in the in our research, is the analysis of the fine structure near of the edge. These fluctuations of the signals that we are seeing here in the edges. So in this case, we see the signature of the sp2 material because we see the pi star peak for both for the boron and the nitrogen. So in this case, okay, we knew that will be the case because we are dealing with a nanotube, so it's a sp2 material. So in this case, it's confirming the kind of analysis that probably we can know in this case a priori. But you see, the three important points: you can do elemental analysis, also the quantification, and the atomic configuration of your material. Okay, so let's go for the first one, for the chemical analysis, the elemental analysis. This is an example from my PhD thesis, but I think that is illustrating very well the capabilities that we see, the way we have. I've been working, as I say, in single-wall boron nitride nanotubes, but apart producing these nanotubes, we had other nanoparticles that they are also produced during the synthesis of these nano objects. And they have a very important impact in the properties at the macroscopic scale of your material. That is always the case. So it's important to analyze them. Then, if I am doing high resolution TEM image, as I've been doing, in this case, you can more or less knowing from the structure of the nanoparticles what is the chemistry of some of them. For instance, this one is easy to recognize, that can be something related with boron nitride. But what about the other ones? Here I can see the boron nitride, but what is inside? In some cases, you can know that it's probably boron. From you can do the analysis of the structure of this nanoparticle, and you can think, okay, that is boron, but it's, the chemistry is not really known. So for that, we perform EELS analysis, and here you see an example of an agglomerate of nanoparticles, that is the high angular annular dark field image, and we perform here an spectrum image over this area. The whole EELS spectrum is this one. So it's the addition of all the spectra that have been collected in this area. And from this spectrum, we can do the chemical analysis that I mentioned before. So I can see the distribution of the different elements. So we can see the boron KH, so the boron, the carbon, the calcium, L2-3, the nitrogen over there, and the oxygen, all the H's that we are seeing here in the spectrum. But as you can see from the elemental analysis, we can see that there are some correlations between the elements. That is something that is easy also to understand because we know that we have boron nitride, so the relationship between boron and nitrogen is the natural one. But we can see that there are also some interactions between the boron, the oxygen, and the calcium. That is something that we need to know in order to understand better this material. So we will see, we will come back later to this example to see if we can extract extra information from this kind of spectrum images. Okay, so the second aspect is the quantification, which is also a very important one because we are performing an analytical technique, so we need to know what is the real composition of your material. You need to have some numbers because it's something that is important for everything. So in this case, EELS in general is not an absolute a quantitative technique, because if you see here this expression, we can see that the signal that we are collecting, which depend on the loss energy and the beta, which is the collection angle of the spectrometer, is proportional to this kind of parameters. N, which is the number of atoms, so the number that you need to know, sigma, which is the cross section of this interaction, which depend on the delta E, so the loss energy and the beta. And this value here, this intensity here, which is the part that we really, in most of the cases, we don't know what is the intensity from the source. Now it's possible to have a cap, Faraday cap, and measure that, or you have the possibility to do dual EELS and to perform something a little bit better, but it's something that you can, in principle, is hard to get this information. So in order to have some quantification, you can do a relative approximation, so you can compare or you can estimate the quantification of two elements, in this case boron and nitrogen, three or whatever the number of elements that you have. And here how is possible to do that. In this case, as you see, we are not any more concerned about this intensity, as we have the relation between the signal that we are collecting and the cross section, something that can be calculated via Hall trace later, for instance, or model or so on. And in this case, you will have the number of atoms. Something that is important is the background that you can see here, this black, because it's after subtraction, is something that you need to do following this law, for instance. And you will see the impact that they have, the proper background, also in the quantification of the signal. So it's something that you need to do in a real proper way in order to be more precise in the quantification. Knowing that, these are the more or less the detection and quantification limits. Something that is important to keep in mind is that, following all these comments that I already did, the precision that we have in EELS is between 10 and 15%. It's not bad. We have the advantage that it's a local technique, but the precision, in most of the cases, you can go far below these numbers and go to few percent of incertitude, but it's around 10-15%, because there is this aspect that they are related with the signal to noise ratio and the signal to background ratio, and also to the signal shape. So regarding what is the edge that you will analyze, in this case the detection limit and the quantification is compromised, could be compromised. Something that is very important and is always something that you need to be aware is the problems that you can have regarding the contamination and the damage of the sample. It's something that I am always checking after the analysis, after the performing the recording the spectra. I will check if I have some contamination or damage of the sample, because in this case, for sure, you cannot trust the analysis that you have been doing. Okay, and two other aspects that you need to consider is the thickness of your sample and the collection angle, the beta that I already mentioned. And we will see the effect of these two parameters. So, regarding the thickness, we are dealing with an absorption technique, and in this case we can follow the Lambert law, and in this case we can see that in any absorption event, you can know that the intensity from the beginning is equal to the intensity that you are detecting, and in this case by this exponential expression where you have the T and the lambda. T is the thickness of your sample and lambda is the mean free path of the inelastic scattering, which is saying you how far is traveling an electron before losing some extra energy. Okay, and as always in physics. So this lambda can be estimated and calculated following this expression. And here we see an example, clear example, what is happening once the T over lambda, which is the parameter that we are always considering, is 0.2, that is the best kind of T over lambda that you can have, between 0.1, 0.2, but 0.1 is really thin materials, almost close to the monolayer and so on into the materials. And the other one is, sorry, because I don't see 2.2. You see here the effects of the thickness, because you see here the second and the third plasma and so on, which is the loss, the inelastic loss that the electrons are having due to the strong thickness or the high thickness of the material. So sorry, now it's not moving. Yes, see here you see other example to illustrate these problems that we can have once the thickness or the T over lambda is too high, and here we see that once the T over lambda is over 0.5, really you have not the possibility to trust too much the quantification that you are performing. So keep in mind, you need to be around 0.2, 0.3, the maximum 0.5, but really in the maximum, because if not, as you can see here in this example of iron oxide, it will be tough to have something that is really reliable in order to give some numbers. Okay, so that is an example for illustrating that. The second point that I was saying is, or the second aspect that you need to consider once you are seated in the microscope before performing the analysis, is the collection angle. Here we have also an illustrative example how it's affecting the quantification once you are not selecting the correct collection angle. Here we have silicon carbide. So the stoichiometry should be 1:1, so 50% of any one, or of both of them. But you see, once the collection angle is very small in this case, you can have easily around 10-12% of error. Or you are underestimating the real concentration of your sample. So the value that you need to more or less estimate if you want to do something proper in terms of the quantification is that this beta, this collection angle, should be 2 or 3 times the characteristic angle. What is this theta E, which is called the characteristic angle, is the relationship between the loss energy that you are analyzing and the energy of the electrons, the initial energy of the electrons. So it's something that is easy to estimate. And as I say, before performing the analysis or before performing the experiment, keep this number in mind and put you in the correct situation for performing the analysis. Okay. So the last example, the last aspect that I wanted to discuss is this analysis of the illness, the fine structure near of the edge. As I say, we have the elemental analysis, we have already discussed about that, the quantification, and the third one is this one. Here we can illustrate with this example the capabilities that we have in EELS. You see here different boron compounds, that is coming from my thesis. And you can see here the power of the technique. You see that for different boron compounds, or kind of you will see that is for different elements is always the same. The fine structure, so these fluctuations of the signal can be completely different between the pure boron and the boron oxide. You can see that, for instance, the boric acid is completely, the boron KH is completely similar to this one of the boron oxide, because you have only one, as we can see, that is an extra water molecule that is a little bit forming the acid. So it's the same, the boron environment is the same. You have also the boron carbide and the boron nitride for two different phases, the cubic and the hexagonal one. And you see here the difference between the sp2 material, the hexagonal one, with the signature of the pi star, which is completely absent once you are analyzing pure cubic volumetry. As I say, another material that is very interesting in order to prove the atomic configuration of the material itself is the carbon materials, no? And the different carbon allotropes. So you see here something that we know very well from EELS because it's the amorphous carbon that is everywhere, and that is the KH of the carbon for this kind of amorphous materials, the diamond, and the graphite in this case with the signature of the pi star, like in the hexagonal boron nitride. We have been working in my group a lot in the estimation of sp2 sp3 materials because there is a real interest and something that has been done. So in the recent years we have been publishing several papers in order to find the way, the most reliable way to analyze this sp2 sp3 ratio. So now I am coming back to the example that I said regarding the boron nitride, the boron nanoparticles, how it's possible to go further. Remember, that is the spectrum, the HDF image of where we collected this spectrum image. And if I am analyzing some areas of this agglomerate, we can see that we can have different signals. That is the boron KH collected in the different points that I am highlighting here in the image. I can compare with some reference, these ones that I mentioned before, and you can see that it's easy to recognize some of them. The first four that I am listing here are clearly the same that the reference that we know here, the boron oxide, and the hexagonal BN, which is an anisotropic material. And in this case, we can also prove the anisotropy. I am not talking today about the momentum resolve EELS, but it's something that is already visible there. The changes that you can have once you are selecting the different momentum, or different transitions in this case of the events. And after you have these other four here, which are a combination of these different signals. You see here the number five that can be probably related with boron oxide and the boron, pure boron and so on. So the idea that we had already a few years ago was to go, as I say, a little bit and a step further in the analysis, not only to stop in the chemical analysis, in the elemental analysis, but trying to see if it's possible to have configuration analysis, atomic configuration analysis, so the chemical bonding of this material. And for that, we developed this multi-least square feet, where the signal that we are collecting is a linear combination of the signals of the different reference. SA is, for instance, the signal of boron, SB will be the boron oxide, and the linear coefficients that we are seeing here, A, B, C, whatever, is the weight of the signal, so the contribution of this signal to the complete, to the total signal. Okay, so that is the procedure. You can go to this paper in ultramicroscopy and you see all the details. And here is the analysis. So as you can see, I am putting here everything. As you can see now, performing this kind of analysis, you can know exactly what is the real chemistry of your material at the nano or even atomic scale. And we can see that we have boron that can be covered by a thin layer of boron oxide and by boron nitride. And as you see, that is why I say that is the power of EELS, because you can have the best local analysis, chemistry local analysis of your material. And that is something that cannot be done in other analytical techniques. Knowing that, I wanted also to describe a little bit how it's possible to get this kind of analysis done at the atomic scale, so spatially resolved EELS. And the first example, one of the first examples, is this one of Maria Varela when she was in Oak Ridge. She was working on this perovskites, and they could, or she could, see really the signature of these different atoms. So having the possibility to perform EELS at the atomic level and to distinguish each of the atoms. As you see, it's more than 15 years ago, so the technique has evolved too much, and we'll see something a little bit more impressive. As is, for instance, for me, this example that is old, is already 11 years old, but for me is still one of the best in order to illustrate the capabilities of the technique. That has been developed by Kazuo Enaga in Japan. You see here a monolayer of graphene, and they were analyzing this atomic resolution, the different signatures of the different carbon atoms, depending of the environment of these carbon atoms. Once it's here in the middle of the network, or is here at the edge, at different position of the edges, and you see here in the carbon edge the different peaks that they are corresponding for to these different atomic configurations of the carbon atoms. So you see here the possibilities that we have. We have been doing the same in this case in a carbon nanotube doped by nitrogen. And you can see here that from the image, it's really hard to know if we were analyzing this area, if there is something different to the carbon atoms composing the network. There is in the HLF image, you can see that this bright spot here that could be related with the presence of nitrogen. Think that nitrogen has only one extra electron comparing with carbon, so it's hard for HLF images to discern between them. But EELS is offering this possibility. So we have the possibility to perform spectrum images at atomic resolution. And in this case, we see here the nitrogen cage, which is indicating really that we were dealing with nitrogen in this location. We can also perform the analysis of the atomic configuration of this nitrogen, so the analysis of the illness. And in this case, we prove that this nitrogen is in a graphitic configuration, in a substitutional configuration. So it means that the nitrogen is replacing the carbon atom in the network. So again, it's something to illustrate the possibilities that we have now in terms of atomic resolution and the kind of analysis that we can perform. Finally, I will discuss the second part of the analysis that we can do in EELS, which concern the low loss, this region, as I say, below 50 dBs. And for that, it will be better if you have the possibility to perform that in a monochromatic microscope, because for analyzing this kind of, but it's not always necessary. But in most of the cases, in the samples that I will illustrate, you need to have a very good energy resolution, and for that you need to use monochromators or the combination of monochromators with other software implementation. So in this paper, you can see the difference in terms of different kind of GANs in the microscope. So the shock effect, Cold effect, and the monochromatic one. Now the best energy resolution that you can get is below 5 millielectron volts. Here we have 9, but it's more than enough for most of the low loss analysis that you want to perform once you have something that is around 180 millielectron volts. So the applications of this of the analysis of this part of the EELS spectrum, one of the first ones, and is not the first one, but it's one that is something that has been done in the materials, is to perform optical measurements, and in order to know, for instance, the optical band gap or the optoelectronic optical band gap. And in this example from Rafferty and Brown is something that has been performed in the case of gallium nitride in this example of sodium lazar and so on. And you can see what are the difference of the direct or indirect band gap in this gallium nitride materials. So another example is this one that has been published from my group, has been published this week, is regarding this molybdenum disulfide, molybdenum tungsten disulfide, so alloying degrees, alloying flakes of TMDs, transition metal decalcogenides, and you can know that it's possible to measure again from the onset of this excitation, what is the optical band gap of this material. It's something that if you have interest, you can go to this paper. I have other ones in boron nitride from the past, but okay, I don't have time to explain all these details, but it's the analysis of this region over here. And the second example that I wanted to present you is the studies, the plasmonic studies of metal in nano objects. It's something that has been developed since almost 40 years, the analysis of the plasmon response of any material by EELS, as you see here, the works of Batson and Christian Collier's groups, and so from the 80s, beginning of the 80s. But I think that everything was much more was getting more importance once you have the access to better resolution in terms of a monochromator, or in this case some software analysis from Richardson, Lucy and so on. And this paper, this seminal paper of Jensen Nelaya and the Oxe team, is illustrating very well the capabilities that we have in terms of the study of the plasmonics, because you can see that it's possible to detect the plasmon resonance of the, these silver nano triangles, and the distribution of the field or the electric field for each of these resonance. So it's something that is now more or less growing, and people are really interested in this technique. I've been also working on this area since more or less 15 years, and this is an example that I think that is illustrating well the capabilities that we have. Because okay, once you are studying the plasmonics of any material, you have three parameters that they are determining this, the plasmonic response, which is the shape of the nanoparticle or the nano object, the size, and also the environment, the electric environment of the material. So here we were analyzing these gold nano rings that they were formed for some transformation, chemical transformation of these gold spheres, hollow spheres. And this is the kind of analysis that you can perform. That is one of these plasmon resonance, that is, I am not going through the details, but is this mode at 1.675 that is coming from this symmetric coupling of the modes. And here is, I think, the most interesting part, which is for different aspect ratio of these gold nano rings, so different sizes of these nano rings, the plasmonic response, as you can see here, is modulated, is changing. At some point, even you can control this the response regarding if you can control the chemistry and the size of your object. But you see here the how is everything evolving, how the plasmonic response is modified due to only the aspect ratio. That is the simulation that is confirming everything. And after you can see how is the dispersion of these modes, and you can get more or less something that is interesting for the application of this material. What is the aspect ratio that you need to have in your material in order to have a particular plasmonic response of this object? So everything can be analyzed by EELS, as I say, at the local scale. And the last example that I wanted to mention is that once you have very good energy resolution coming from these new monochromators, you can have the possibility not only to analyze the band gap and the plasmons, you can also even investigate the phonons. So this example, which was the first one dealing with this matter, is coming from the work of André Kirivanek, that they were analyzing the phonons of a hexagonal BN, and you have the possibility to prove here this this phonon mode at 173 millielectron volts, which correspond to the E2G mode, something that you can also analyze by another inelastic technique like Raman spectroscopy. So that is also a field that is growing very, very fast and has an interest in different kind of fields, not only material science, also bio, even the pharmaceutical industry. They are interested to distinguish from this kind of analysis, the kind of molecules and so on. And with that, I conclude the lecture. I think that I was illustrating the capabilities that we have in EELS to study our materials. But I also mentioned the aspect that should be considered. As I say, the thickness is one of the most important ones, because you see, at least not only for the quantification, but for other kind of analysis. But something that is interesting to always think about is before going to the microscope or to perform the measurement, think the correct configuration of the microscope for getting the information that you want. And with that, I think that I will conclude. Here is a list of books, or yes, mainly they are books that you can get much more information about EELS. And thank you in any case for your attention. Hello.
Thank you, Dr. Raoul.
Yes.
Yeah, let's begin with today's question and answer. The first question for today is, does webinar XPS and EELS give the same results? It's by Neha Sharma from University of Jammu.
Okay, that is a very good question. I am, since several years, four, five or six years, I am combining XPS and EELS. At some point, I can say yes in terms of the chemical analysis. You need to be aware that XPS is a surface technique, so you will have only information about the 5-10 nanometers at the surface of your material, even if after, I know, you can do some etching and you can go farther in the material, but that is the first difference. I think that at some point they are complementary. The information could be, it could be better always to have the combination of both. At least for some complicated or complex materials, is my experience that I will try to combine both.
Okay. Can we use EELS to perform depth profiling in terms of bonding compositions available?
Yes, that is the example that I was showing for the boron material. It's something that can be done also for iron. Is something that we have been doing that even in 3D, because I was not talking today, but you can combine other techniques in the microscope, like atomic tomography and performing tomography and combining with EELS, and you can get the information about the bonding state or the valence state or the oxidation state of your material by EELS, looking for to the fine structure near of the edge to the illness. So yes, it's something that can be done. It's done always.
Is EELS better technique than EDS analysis? Is it cost effective? What is the error bar?
That is also a very good one. All the questions are very appropriate, but usually once I am giving this lecture, I am starting to compare with EDS. Today I was, in 45 minutes, I couldn't have the time to do that. Again, like in the XPS, it's always good to combine both EDS and EELS. In terms of something that you will miss for sure in EDS is that you don't have this energy resolution that we are having in EELS. So you are missing all this bonding information, all this illness, the information that you can get from illness. The principle is different in both cases. So I cannot say if one is better than the other, even if I have some preference. It depends on the material that you will analyze. For sure, something that is very useful for an EDS is that you have a much broader information in terms of the elemental analysis, even the quantification, if it's something that is done correctly. That is not ever always the case, because something that is a problem, I consider that is a problem in EDS, that is very easy to have a result. You are pressing a button, you are collecting an EDS spectrum, but you are not probably doing that in the right way in order to have the quantification and so on. But at least elemental analysis can be also some of the positive aspects of EDS. But again, I will push to combine, if it's possible, both.
Yeah. Apart from the principle of EELS, what background knowledge should one have while analyzing one sample? Can two different elements show same peak? How to distinguish them?
Yes. Yes, a same element can have different peaks. Yes, that is the sample that I've been discussing of boron again, or the same for oxygen, for iron, for different elements. The previous analysis that you need to perform, I want to say that previous, but in parallel, it's always good, apart EDS, as I mentioned, it's also good to have some structural analysis, because it will help once you have some doubts. Particularly, one is, again, it's a complex situation. Once you have something that is complicated, from structural analysis, from high resolution STEM or high resolution TM, or even electron diffraction, can bring you more clues, more information about your material, and you can know better what is happening. Because something that I didn't push too much is I saw the example. For instance, with this nitrogen dope carbon nanotube, the example that I mentioned before, for us was a real problem. I was not discussing everything. You can go to the nanolatest paper and you will see. I say at the end, once we were analyzing the final structure near of the edge of the nitrogen cage, we could conclude that that was a substitutional configuration of the nitrogen. It was not really true at the beginning. We should perform also some simulations, DFT calculations and so on, in order to know what was the atomic configuration that we were collecting. So if you have this extra information coming from the structural analysis, or you have the possibility to perform several ab initio calculations in order to know what is the potential atomic configurations that you have in your sample, that will be not only better, but also in some cases even needed. So yes, it could be tricky.
So last question for today's talk, a simple one. Is EELS better with a cold peg or thermal peg?
Also a good one. It depends. It's something that you need to know. For instance, if I want to do all these low loss analysis that I was mentioning, if I have the possibility to have a monochromator, okay, you can have a monochromator in a cold peg, but okay. Yes, it's true that in this case, I don't know. For the cold peg, if you are comparing a Schottky peg with a cold peg without monochromator, for sure, the cold peg will be better. I remember the image that I was showing the low loss. For sure, in terms of energy resolution, the cold fake will provide much better energy resolution. For the rest of the for the core losses, in principle, a part of the resolution, the energy resolution that you have, is not so critical. But for the low losses, for sure, if I am not going to a monochromator, I will get I will try to get the cold fake. Yes.
On behalf of CFCRNTS, we would like to thank Dr. Raul Arnold for an interesting talk on EELS principles, instrumentation, techniques, and illustrative examples. We are really grateful, Dr. Raul Arnold, for answering the questions. We would like to thank our head, Professor Anil Kotantarail, for his support in this webinar, and Professor Leela Panchkala for introducing Dr. Rao. And last but not the least, we thank all the participants for attending this webinar and making this event successful. A link for the feedback form is shared in the chat box. Please fill the form. Your valuable inputs are important for us. Once again, thank you all for making this webinar successful.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you, Rod, for joining.
Thank you, Leela. It has been a pleasure. I don't know if everything was clear.
It is. Yeah. I have actually one question. Maybe it is.
Yes.
We can cut maybe later. Yeah. So when, for example, operator has to take care, let's say if you have a sample with very low doping percentage, okay, let's say if I have a nitrogen 1 or 2% in a carbon network like graphene, and what are the operator, like what is supposed to take care to get the accurate information?
For this particular case, for instance, for once you, it's very difficult. You soon, once the doping level is very low, I recommend you to perform that in a dedicated instrument. If not, it will be very, 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 very tough to collect this signal. For instance, the sample that I was illustrating, this one of the nitrogen doped carbon nanotubes, we were working on a dedicated instrument, and we were working, I don't remember the number of sessions, but a lot, 15, 16, analyzing close to 100 nanotubes. Because once you have only few atom percent, in this case was less than 1% of nitrogen, you need to find the area where you have the nitrogen. That is not tricky. No, easy. It's really tricky. And after you spend a lot of time in order to get the proper signal. And you need to be aware that is something that can be easy damage. You have all these problems of contamination in these cases. So it's really, in some cases, could be tough. But if you have a good sample, and a good instrument, in this case, the things that you need to control is are more or less the stability of the sample. I would say that yes, that is a matter of time. It's a matter of time, and for sure you need to have some experience in order to perform this analysis and. It's possible. Nowadays, there are a lot of examples in the literature about that. But
okay. And another thing about the background correction. So when you collect the signal and we have a background, and most of the times you ask software to correct it for you. But how operator can cautiously look at that whether the software has done the correct job? I mean, is the background correction is important, how important it is, and how operator can take care of that, where software has done a good job.
Yes, that is also very, it's a critical one. You know, you need to really do the background subtraction is also important, particularly if, as I say, if you want to do a proper quantification. Right. If you are not going through the quantification and you don't care too much, if you want to stay only for the elemental analysis, it's not so critical because, okay, You, but once, if I am doing some, you know, practical lecture, I always illustrate how it's possible to have some differences, not too important ones, could be only 2-5% of difference if the background is not properly substrated. So that is the point. The thing that you can have around even 5% of error that is coming from the wrong background substration. How to do that is, it will always be better to have an example and to see the And the background substration is also important, not only for the quantification, I forgot, also for the analysis of the illness, for the analysis of the fine structures, because if you are not doing that in the proper way, there are peaks that can be there and that they are not considered because you probably miss them doing the wrong background substration.
Okay. And one final question. Sorry for holding you, but for example, in our case, let's say strontium cobaltate, what you have analyzed, we also try to do it our end, just to, you know, compare and see whether we can do it in a similar job. So if you look at the peaks are well separated energetically, you know, for these elements. But while doing quantification, is it, how do you do that for this kind of samples which peaks are well separated energetically?
So in this case, it will be better if you don't have the possibility to do dual yields, which is the best in order to perform the quantification, if you don't have the Faraday cap. In this case, the best way is to have, if they are very well separated, to have a large spacing, you know, to cover with the same core loss spectrum the different elements in order to do the quantification of all of them simultaneously. It cannot be done if if you are not really covering all the elements in the same. If not, cannot be done. And after is more or less, as I say, doing the proper background substration and being more or less careful about the how you are doing the estimation, but
nice. Great. Thank you so much, Dom.
No, thank you, Leda. So I don't know. We're keeping these guys in touch.
One more question, can I ask?
Yes.
So you talked about ends of boron K at eight different positions. So what was the thickness variations at these locations?
Also very good point. So the variation thickness in this case, in this example, is there are nanoparticles that they are not too thick. They were of only 20, 25 nanometers, but the thickness is, I don't know if I can share again my presentation, because that you will see that here. It's something that we were analyzing, the thickness effect. You can go to the ultra microscopy work, the paper. And that has been done for, we were fitting, selecting the correct window, energy window, because, and in this case was 18 electron volts. So we were covering, as you see here, you see the fit is covering from 888 more or less to 206, because this window, this one that is here in the fitting window, in the fit result, it was the best in order to avoid some thickness effect. And I can, again, let me see if I have here the result. If not, you can go to the to the ultra microscopy, but I can have probably let me see if I have the example here. No, I don't have. I don't have that. It's a pity. But okay, we were changing the energy window, and we saw the thickness effect. If you are selecting, but 25 EVs, you see that the thickness is taking an effect, and the fit was really not so good. Okay. So in this case, we were lucky that they were not so thick, but at least we saw the thickness effect. Let me see if it's here. It's probably is below. No. Sorry.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So. Okay. Thank you again, and we keep in touch. Good luck with the exam.